Hey everybody, Fraser Hatyai here from Online Teachers Club. I've just put together all the footage from the meetup event. Unfortunately, I didn't get all the footage. I was kind of a bit excited and caught up in the event that I didn't really pay much attention to what the cameras were doing. I also apologize. I said I would live stream the event, but I kind of forgot to bring a stand for my phone, so I couldn't attach it to a tripod. Anyway, the event went really well. I was very pleased with how things went. The comments and emails I received from you guys after was great too. It was cool to see that people got value from the speakers and are working on applying for online jobs or setting up their own schools now, so that's really cool. I do hope to run another event in around 3 months, and I'm also thinking about the possibility of just doing a kind of social meetup event where we, instead of having a conference, it's more informal. We meet in a bar or a restaurant and we just kind of have a networking session, get to know different teachers, different people doing different things with regards to online teachers, and just have a friendly chat. So I'll look at setting those things up in the coming weeks, but without further ado, I will play the content that I managed to collect and stitch together from the meetup event. Here it is.
As you can probably guess, I don't do Muay Thai anymore. I no longer have a red mohawk. That's the first reason I came here, and as the story goes, fell in love with Thailand. I decided to find a way to stay here. So the first thing I did was what most of us do, is find a teaching job. I taught English in Vietnam and China and Thailand for around, the last 8-9 years really. I taught mainly in Thailand. I visited Vietnam a couple times to do English camps and short-term contracts. So as you can see, I've done pretty much every kind of teaching you could think of, from teaching kindergarten to corporate work to pretty much everything. So later on, after being in Thailand for a while, I discovered that I could also teach online. Does any of you recognize any of these companies here? Yeah, so these are some of the companies that I work for. The first one I worked for was called Talk Animated, and they use a really crazy platform like this. So as you can see, you get a group of students here.
You can teach
using. They can reply to you with audio, and you can control their microphones. And here you've got myself where you teach.
So this is one of the
more basic
platforms for teaching online
when I first started. I then found this company, Dada, and here's me sat
in my garden, working,
teaching English to Thomas
in China.
So this is a platform that
focuses on teaching kids online,
and I've been doing this for about 4 years now, and this is one of the best platforms, I think.
We'll talk about how you can apply for these schools later.
I then moved even further and I started teaching groups of kids online. And at this point I quit my offline teaching jobs and I was doing this full time. So what did I do next? After a while, and after I built a lot of experience teaching online, I thought, why don't I just do this myself? So I thought I would set up my own school and start freelancing online. So I started Flairtalk to teach kids in Vietnam, China and Thailand online, and ODC to help other teachers do the same.
So one of the ways I attracted students to freelance online was by creating video content.
So one way to attract students, especially in Vietnam and Thailand, it's more difficult in China because there's no Facebook.
You have to use Chinese social media, which we'll get into later.
But in the end, I built a page of about 1,200 students, and out of that, I had about 1% of that became paying customers, which is what you usually expect. So I'm just going to talk briefly about some of the platforms, because later we're going to have some speakers who have set up even bigger projects than this online. So this is a platform called LearnQ. I know one of the guys here, Henry, is going to speak about this platform. It's basically the whole package for an online teacher. With this application, LearnQ, you can take payments, you can organize bookings, and you can even teach through your browser. So it's really easy and convenient for the student, because they don't have to download any applications. All they need to do is go to the link that you send them, and you're straight in an online class. So this is the first platform I used for my own online business. I then started experimenting and trying different types of online teaching. This is a class in Vietnam that I taught for almost a year. And at first I thought this was ridiculous, it's not going to work, the logistics of it. But it actually, after trial and error, it turned out pretty well. And basically, I was on a big TV at the top of the classroom, and I had a teaching assistant that would pass around a microphone, and I could engage and interact with the students. I'm going to show you a quick video of what that looks like now. So as you can see, here I am at the top of the classroom. Things, and we ended up using this model for almost 6 months, and we taught an entire group of 30 to 40 kids, one teacher to a whole class, online. And this was done through my own company and the contacts I made while I was traveling and teaching in Vietnam. So this is a great option, and this is becoming very popular in China now. There's a lot of big online Chinese companies that will have you teaching whole classes like this. Okay, let me continue the presentation. Okay, so I then started doing this in Thailand too. And in Thailand, I started doing it more with companies, corporate jobs. So this is a company that, an agency that sends students study abroad from Thailand, and I got a contract to teach these three students. They were the staff at the company for a whole year, and to try and get their English speaking ability up. So this is another great way of teaching online. One person, two, three students. This application is called Zoom. It's a free application that you can use to teach English online, and it's very, very popular, and it works great. You can share your screen, you can do tons of things. I'm not going to show you the video now, because I want to get on some of the other speakers, but I do have a video of this. So why did I decide to host this meetup? As I said, I created my own company teaching English online, and then I decided to start what we got here, OTC, to help other teachers do the same. Okay, so what is OTC? This is going to be a very short sales pitch, and then we'll get back to the content. Okay, so OTC is a complete package for online teachers. You pay a monthly fee, and you get access to courses training you how to teach online, training you how to freelance and find students, how to set up your own company, and how to just teach an awesome class, tips and tricks how to do it. Complete online course. Most people who join this teach kids online. And what we use when we teach kids online is props. Props are very important. And it's also important to change up your props, because it's like the shiny ball. If you show a kid a shiny ball, eventually that ball becomes dull and you have to go and get another shiny ball. It's the same with teaching props. So with OTC, we send you a box of teaching props each month as part of the membership. Okay, that's the sales a bit over. So how do you get an online teaching job? At OTC, if you go to this link, onlineteachersclub.com/jobs, you can fill out your information and we will select jobs that will be suitable for you to apply for, depending on if you're a native speaker, a non-native speaker, a degree holder or a non-degree holder. We will select the companies that are more likely to hire you. Okay, this is completely free. You can go to that link and find positions that would suit you. We also have a mega list on this website. If you change this to mega list, you will get a list of over 300 online schools that are hiring at the moment, and a little bit of information about each one, so you can do your own research and look into it as well. But if you go through this link, we kind of do the hard work for you and select the jobs that are suitable for you. Okay, so here's the link where you can apply. And on that little card that you got when you came in, we also give you a $10 discount if you did want to join the OTC, which is training, teaching props, and job mentorship as well. We will help you personally find an online job. Okay, so I'd like to welcome on the next speaker now. The next speaker is Rob. He has set up his own online teaching school, and a very successful one with Thai students and some Chinese students too. And he's gonna talk about the process and his situation when he was doing that and his successes and what went wrong. So I'd like to
much of your time here. So as he said, my name is Rob, and it's awesome to see all of you guys here today on a Saturday afternoon. Just want to say a big thank you to Fraser, because putting this together is not easy, and you have to find a venue, you have to get the camera set up and all the speakers, so thank you to Fraser for putting this together. Get this thing out of here. So, about 2 to 3 years ago, I was at Suvarnabhumi Airport. I was going on vacation with a friend of mine named John, and we were waiting in line to check in, and about 20, 25 minutes later, we got to the front, and then I overheard a conversation next to me, and someone was having difficulty explaining about their baggage to the check-in person. So I put on my nice guy hat, and I went over, and I did some translation, and came back in, and they were all set. So I go to my friend, John, and I took off my nice guy hat. I said, even in a fucking airport, they can't speak English. And I was talking to the boarding area. I thought about the online aspect of this. I said, there's this huge need for English here, and the internet is now really fast. And in Thailand, it's reached a point where almost everybody can stream a video. So I said, hey, let's do this online. And my friend John will tell you that I completely ruined our whole vacation because I couldn't stop thinking about this. I was thinking about the little details of, you know, what sort of backgrounds the teachers have or how to hire teachers, how to get through this whole thing. So what I did is I just started contacting people in the industry. I went to teachers that were already teaching online. I talked to VIP Kid. I joined VIP Kid and started to teach with them, really to learn about the industry. It was really interesting for me. If you fast forward to today, we now have 32 teachers that work with us. We've written our own curriculum. We have 550 classes that we've made. And I feel like we are making some sort of a difference here, so that feels good. So this is not a roadmap to success. This is a roadmap about how not to get lost within any sort of industry where you're starting your own business. A little bit to a background. I've been here for 15 years. I have a wife and two kids, and I started working here with the Ministry of Education. My background is in developmental psychology, and so I felt like it was very fitting to work with the MOE here. We worked on projects to really try to change the education system here. This is 15 years ago. I was way over my head. I didn't really know what I was doing, but I knew that my education that I had in the US was a very good one, and I wanted to bring some of that knowledge here. So this was around 13 years ago. It was under the Thaksin administration. Thaksin got taken out because of one of the many coup d'etats that happened here. We were given 30 days to leave. Luckily, at that point, I had started some side businesses. One was a social networking site called ThailandFriends.com. We had about 150,000 members. It was pre-Facebook, so it was really the only one that was available, so that's why it grew to be so big. I started my own bar. I'm a super good soy 11 down here. What else did I do? I was in the online gaming industry as well, doing marketing for that. And throughout all this, it was really just building a network, learning about things, making mistakes, trying to get back up again. And I think a lot of people here are similar in the sense that if you are aspiring to be a teacher or aspiring to be an entrepreneur, you might be a bit scatterbrained. I'm scatterbrained like crazy. I have 100 ideas, and that's good, but it's also can hurt you in the future. So one thing, one do, is to stay being scatterbrained, that's fine. But you need to look at one or two of your ideas and go with them. The problem with a lot of entrepreneurs is that you get 5 or 10 ideas, you start on 1 and 2, you move to 3 and 4, and you forget what you were doing back at number 1. So stay focused is one of the biggest things. Ideas versus execution. So that's similar to what I was just talking about. Everybody has ideas, and that's 20% of it. Execution is 80%, so you really need to stay on track. It's one of the most difficult things I've ever done, is starting my own business. You're alone. No one gets what you're doing. You can go through financial ups and downs, and it's really difficult. So execution is staying on the right track. Also, hiring people that do what you cannot do. So I stick to the 2 or 3 things that I think I'm really good at, and I outsource the rest of it. We're living in an awesome time now where you can go to Fiverr.com or Freelancer.com and get someone to do graphic designs for $10. So use all the resources that you have, in that sense. So taking safe risks. As a father, I always teach my kids to take risks. I want them to not be afraid about what they're doing in their life. I'm getting dry mouth. And I want them to take risks in the sense that they're going outside of their comfort zone. And so that's what I was doing as well. I was working at KIS International School down the road here. I was doing business development and marketing, and it was an awesome job, good salary. My kids went to an international school for free. And then this idea came up 2 years ago. What I did is I worked on it for about an hour a day after work. My kids would go to sleep, I'd put about an hour a day, and then that turned into 2 hours a day, 3 hours a day, started even to my lunchtime at work. And it got to the point where I was earning some money, and I said, okay, if I want this to go any farther, I need to jump off the cliff. So I quit my job, and I jumped into English Gang full time. This was safe. I knew at that point that if I completely screwed up, I would still be making, you know, 40, 50,000 baht a month, and I could kind of go find another job and find something else to do. But at that point, I realized that I couldn't keep doing a full-time job and try to run a business. So try to have your backup plan. Always be ready for failure, but have success, obviously, in your sights. So what are we here for? If any of you guys are interested in starting your own businesses in this field, you want to look at how do teachers become better teachers. You want to look at what makes the process easier for students as well. Because if you've ever been in an online classroom, it's very different. You only have this much space to work with. You don't have a huge classroom to work with. You can't tell a student over there to pay attention, and you just have to work in a completely different way. So when we look at teachers, what they need, a lot of teachers are traveling all the time, so they need kind of backgrounds for their classes. There's another guy who's going to come to the next meetup, James. He makes puppets. It's a really cool idea. He makes puppets for classrooms. A lot of teachers, they're very good teachers, but they're not able to make cool props. They have to go out and buy them somewhere. And if you're living, you know, in Thailand, or you're living in India or vacationing somewhere, you're not going to go find really cool props over at Walmart for $2. A lot of these teachers will rely on other companies to make these products. So think of ideas that you can bring to the market that will help teachers become better teachers. The Apple model is kind of the final thing. Online teaching, you can assimilate to the iPhone. So you're not going to go out making money selling iPhones, and you're not going to make the next iPhone. But there's an ecosystem around the iPhone. These kind of accessories, the cases that go on your iPhone, the apps. You can build your own company around great products. So you look at VIP Kid, Dada, ABC, English Game. You look at these teachers and see what they need and help them out. So the biggest takeaway with this is, if you're going to start your own business, be safe, but take risks. At the same time, keep on giving. You just always want to give, give, give. At some point, it's going to come back to you. So if you want to stay in touch, my name's Rob. My office is actually here. So we have our full-time staff here. I work primarily from home. I come here maybe 2 days a week. We have been running now for about 2 years. Our launch was about a year and a half ago. And if you guys want to stay in touch, I'm happy to help. If you have any questions at all about the industry or how to start your own business, I have kind of a roadmap that I've gone through. And I know a lot of the mistakes that I made, and I'm happy to share them with you. So thanks to everybody for your time.
Thank you. For watching the videos. My name is Mark, I'm from EWF, which is Educating the World for Free. And we started with information to provide humanitarian and educational support to children in need. Not strictly true, we'll give it to anybody that doesn't have money. All you have to do is be a student and have no money. That's the criteria, really. We stripped it all down to the zero at the end of the day. So if you have money, I'm the wrong person to speak to. Unless you want to give us it, money. Okay, so founded in the 9th of September 2017, and we have centers in Sankthaburi, which is on the borders of Myanmar and Thailand, or Burma. And we also have a new one coming soon in Bangkok, which is south of Wong Vieng Yai, an orphanage there. And we're also at the moment we're in Uluwatu, Bali, Indonesia, and also west of Denpasar in Bali as well. So there's four centers coming. So two countries, Thailand and Indonesia. And who is EWF? Basically, it's an organization, a collective organization of teachers and educationists who've come together to help underprivileged students, children, etc. It's a humanitarian educational program. We originally were going to just be education, but then we encountered the situations in some of the homes where they have no food or they were lacking nutrition. So we then moved into helping them with fruit and vegetables to nourish them, etc. Because at the end of the day, if you're not healthy, if you're not fit, you're not going to be able to learn, or there's no point in teaching them. So education took a secondary to their health and welfare of the children in this case. So we provide only online teachers, but also sometimes I will be on site and then I teach the teachers, or the Thai teachers, the Burmese teachers, to help them sustain and teach their own children at some point or other. So here's the new site we'll be opening up on the 29th of May this year. It's the foundation of Thailand Orphanage, and there's going to be 25 students to start with, aged 7 to 12 years old. And our volunteers, we have 26 teachers so far working with us, all volunteers. They range from quite a few countries across the board. Our only proviso is for teachers is that you have a high proficiency of English. Okay, so we don't say native speakers, non-native speakers. We don't care. At first, we had this great idea that we had only native English speakers, but that's not the reality of the world. The people they're going to come in contact with are people from Italy speaking English, Germany, India, Vietnam, etc. So the realities are they have to be able to speak to pretty much everybody as they're using the bridge language. So what do we do, or what do we give to the volunteers back again? What else do we do? We focus very strongly on experience as an online teacher, so we help them with that. We also provide teacher training and development, so we help them a lot with improving themselves, because some of them have no experience, some have some experience, some just have a big heart. So our job is to make them better teachers for our students and for themselves. The reality is if we make them too good, sometimes they get jobs and then they have to leave because they're so busy. But they've given us 6 months, 3 months, 12 months, we're happy and we wish them good luck. And that carries on. We give them peer and self-assessment tools. So we help train them basically to be better teachers, for free obviously. And we give them references to the teachers, a set of talk for this period, good things, bad things, if they've done more than 3 months with us. So that helps them get a permanent job. and we give them video recorded footage of their class so that they can then present that as part of their resume to show them in action. So they can say, I'm an online teacher, blah, 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 but are they really any good? Or now they've got something to present to the company and say, here's a link to a YouTube, or that's me teaching. Look how good I am. Okay. So it's pretty much, and then an inroad into online teaching industry. So some people don't know how to get into it. They come to us, we help them, we give them the tools, we show them how to use Zoom, we train them on how to use Zoom, etc., how to do shares, resources, away they go. Again, unfortunately, sometimes we lose them, but they've given us enough back, and they've given our children something back, and we give that to them as well. Okay, statistics. Some figures for you. Student classes per week at the moment. This is increasing pretty much every week. And we give 32 classes a week to the Bannerman Children's Home. They used to get 71, but unfortunately we closed it down for a school period and we lost 50% of our teachers. It's always a bad idea closing the holidays, unfortunately, but that was their choice and I think they learned from it that they learned 50%, so we should be higher. But anyway, we're building that back up. 73 in Bali by 4 Finnage in Bali, and then 13 in Jodhia Shares. This now is now expanding to the younger children, because we need the younger children. They're the sponges, they're the best ones to catch hold of. Okay, so top classes at the moment per week is 118 classes. Okay, and that works out a month, 472 classes per month we provide, equals an estimated value of $4,720 donation per month to these children's homes for free. That's what we calculate. This is about $10 an hour for a teacher's time. Sorry, it's $10 as a class for a teacher's time. In reality, that's not if you go through an agency and you pay more. So basically, so far up to what we provided today was $42,480 in free private education to these children, completely free, completely free. Okay, how can you help? We need volunteers, always need volunteers, okay? Then you already know what we'll provide, a minimum of 30 classes per week. We are always, always, always desperate for new or second-hand computers, laptops, tablets, anything that we can, a device that we can use for Zoom. And Zoom pretty much works on anything. It's an amazing piece of the software from zoom.us, okay? So we need anything that you don't want. Your new smartphone, whatever, then send us your old one. Okay, and donations. Unfortunately, the truth is money talks, we do need money. Okay, when their kids break the headsets, we need to replace them. One of our Bali sites only had two laptops, they're always in need of a new laptop. And when we get one, we'll take care of it. Then they have three. Three in an hour means they can have another six classes. Okay, so just with three laptops. So six classes per hour. Okay, this is a testimonial, but I think you've had enough videos. We've had a video at the start, and yeah, my video on this one. This is just a very quick one from one of our teachers, which is Pierre. He's been with us pretty much from the start, and he studies with myself and Fraser.
Hello, my name is Pierre. I'm from South Africa, and this is my short testimonial about starting the EWF program. It has been rewarding on both a personal and professional level, and I've never taught a lesson on an online level.
My name is Henry, and I'm going to be talking about freelancing for beginners. Now, this is a very complex topic, and I'm going to try fit in as much as possible in the time that I have, and hopefully I can give you some ideas that you can take away and you know what to do, what to look for.
Hello?
There we go. So, just an outline of my presentation today. We're going to be talking or looking at my background, the context within which freelancing takes place, building a system and content, finding customers and marketing, and then fitting all the pieces together to get a complete picture. Then we'll have a question and answer if you have any questions, and I will present an opportunity. So, beginning of this meetup, Fraser asked you how many of you are looking to teach online, and probably the majority of you raised your hand, right? So I work with a company that is currently looking for teachers. Now they're not the best company, but if you do want to get into online teaching, just come chat to me after and you know, we can get your details and we can get you talking with the company. Alright, so my background, why am I standing here talking to you today? I've been teaching for 5 years, and it started in 2014 when I did my TEFL course and I started teaching English camps. The following year, I got a job at a private school here in Thailand, and I also started working at two language centers. 2016, I started my BA degree, and at this point my workload was too much. So I made the move online. Now I'm fortunate enough to be able to teach music as well. So I started doing that so that I can work from home and still study, complete my degree. Then in 2017, I asked myself, why can't I, you know, start my own businesses? Why do I have to work for someone else? So I started Kids at Home, which is my own online school project. And I started a music school with my partner, my girlfriend. And 2018, I started Global English Teacher. Why? Because I want to help other teachers follow the same path, but not make the same mistakes that I have made. Now, you can see there are quite a few projects. So I formed a company called LifeStar Systems, within which I can base all my projects. 2019, I started my master's degree, and I started another project called Easy English, catering more to adult learners. Now, at the bottom here, you can see that I only work from home. 65% of my income comes from working for myself. 35% comes from working for and with the online company. Now, the reason I show this to you today is because it's not easy. It's taken me 3 years to get up to this point. However, it is very rewarding. You will learn a lot along the way. Alright, let's chat about freelancing. So what do we need to know before we start our freelancing business? Well, first step is to know your market. Identify other schools, other freelancers, other language centers, other online schools, online courses that are doing or operating within the same market. See what these role players are doing. So you could look at one school and see, oh, okay, their marketing is working well. Let's look at this school. Their textbooks are working well with this type of student. Look at everything that these players are doing. Ask yourself a question, what is working well? What can I improve on? And through going through this process, you can begin to build a list of features that is appealing to you. Conduct an analysis. Look at the advantages and disadvantages of each item that you have in the list. Again, I highly recommend this to get an idea of your niche, where you can freelance in this market. Know your customer. So you have to build a customer avatar. Now this is your ideal customer. Who do you want using your service? Alright, consider the environment within which this customer finds themselves. You know, do they work in a corporate setting? Do they study at university? Look at their behaviors. Where do they frequent? What do they do day in and day out? What are they competent at? What do they value? What identity do they have for themselves? And most importantly, what purpose? Now you want to appeal to your customer's purpose. The reason for this is if your service does not contribute towards them achieving their purpose, well, they're probably not going to use your service. Next, system and content, very important. So you have to build a system. You know, it's not as easy as, okay, I'm just going to freelance, let me go and find students. No, you need systems in place to help you achieve this. I recommend using a mind mapping software called XMind. It's a free to use platform, and you can visualize all the systems for your freelancing business. Just an idea of what type of systems you will need in place. Well, you need an accounting system, a customer management system, a marketing system, content management system, a communication system, a payment system, a booking system, and probably millions more that I haven't even thought of, all right? Once you have built these systems and mapped them out on your mind map, look at relationships between the different systems. List the processes within the systems. Now, once you have done this, you can begin to simplify. If one process is 8 steps, well, maybe you can make it 6. Automate. So maybe there's a piece of software that you can use to automate some of the steps in your systems. And finally, optimize. Maybe there is a better way that you could be doing something. And this will contribute towards you finding success in your freelancing business. All right, content. So you need to have structures. By structures, I mean what courses will you be offering to your customers? All right, are you targeting beginners? Are you just having one level, the beginner level? Is there a next step up? Have structures in place. Have an outcome for each structure. What will the student achieve by the end of this course? And have assessments in place to show students that they are making progress. Now that you know the outcomes, conduct a resource analysis. So what do you have and what do you need to achieve the outcomes that you have set out for your business? All right, finding customers and marketing. This is probably the most difficult part, as Rob can probably attest to, is finding customers to use your service. And this is a very, very competitive industry. There are so many choices that a potential customer can take. So how are you going to reach your customers? Okay, tools. I recommend keeping it simple. Have social media. Only pick one. All right. I made this mistake. I wanted Skype set up, Facebook set up, WeChat, Line, all of them. But it's too difficult to manage. So I recommend picking Facebook, all right? Everyone's got Facebook. Email marketing. I don't know if any of you have heard of MailChimp. All right, this is a free to use service. You can build landing pages. You can send out emails to all of your customers. And finally, content creation. Another website called Canva. Free to use. You can build infographics, Facebook ads, certificates, pretty much anything you can think of, all for free. Alright, you need to build a funnel, a process to get your customer using your service. So you have your Facebook page. Show credibility, make a live video, get reviews on your Facebook page. Provide more value through, you know, giving out free worksheets, sharing YouTube videos to improve their pronunciation, so on and so forth. And you then step in and give them a chance to join your email list. Now, once they're on your email list, what you will do is you will provide more value. Again, send out worksheets, send out useful tips, phrases that they can use to improve their English. And through your email list, you can then say, well, if you want to step it up a level, I have online English classes you can learn through me. All right, you can see that you have built a relationship with your customer from starting on Facebook to selling your service. The chance that you will find success increases. Other methods I don't recommend is traditional advertising. So this is what I did for my music school, is sticking up posters on street signs, sticking flyers in mailboxes. You probably won't get much results from that. Be active in forums. You know, there are many Facebook groups where people want to learn English. You can be active in there and direct them to your Facebook page. And finally, networking. Have a network. So if Rob teaches young children English, I teach adults English, perhaps we can have a working relationship where I send him younger students that come through my channel. He can send me some of the adults that comes through his channel. Right? It's a mutually beneficial partnership. Alright, a complete picture. So this whole sphere that you see here is the market. Here is your customer. Your customer will be bought into your system through marketing. Once they are in your system, your email list, they can use your product or your service. You have built a relationship with them. Once they are using your service, you can use them to review your freelancing business. Get them.
Okay guys, thanks for your patience, and just wanted to see if we can do some questions now, if anybody has any huge questions they want answering. Come on guys, go to, yeah.
Well, thanks everyone. I thought every presentation was valuable. Good. For me, the elephant in the room is legality. So everyone I've talked to has said that I need to keep quiet about this, which falls in the face of promoting yourself. So what's the latest in Thailand?
You mean the legality of teaching English online based in Thailand?
Yes.
Okay. So I think officially it is illegal to do any kind of work without a work permit within Thailand. But I did read a few different interviews people did with the work permit office, and they did discuss the topic of online teaching, and what they pretty much said is if you're in your apartment teaching English online, it's fine. If you want to target Thai customers though, then that's you're probably going to need to register a Thai company and do it all completely legal. Maybe do you want to say anything on that?
Sure. So if you, like, for example, a lot of our teachers here are just not based in Thailand. They live in the US, Canada, UK. But for the ones that do come to us that want to work here and within Bangkok or anywhere in Thailand, we tell them it's not legal, and, you know, read between the lines, if you're registered here and you're going to be working here, we don't allow it. So what some of them might do is register somewhere else, but work from here.
Register meaning what?
So when we take in their information, we ask them where they live. And if they say that they're working here, and they haven't worked for a company and they have no experience, we will not give them a work permit and say, you can't work for us. We have 3 teachers that we offer work permits and visas for, but they've been with us for a while, and we have a long-term relationship. So a lot of the time, it's just kind of keep it quiet, and you can work. But I didn't say that.
What's the latest with that? Because I've been told, like, when I tried to volunteer during the flood in 2011, yeah. Like, no, you can't because we're not going to sponsor you.
Our teachers are all friendly. All virtual, they're from around the world. So they come to us and they teach. And again, I suppose there are a couple in Thailand, they're from South Africa. It's a bit like yourself, as far as we're concerned, they're in South Africa. Have they been given the details to sign into?
So this whole question is debated online all the time about can digital nomads work online legally in Thailand? Do they need a work permit? It's actually almost impossible to get a work permit unless you're working for a Thai online company like his. But from what I've read, and from interviews I've read between digital nomads and people in the work permit office, is what they said is, as long as your customers are not Thai, and you're doing it from your comfort of your own home, we're not really concerned with that. And I've seen that a few times, and there's been no record of anybody being busted or facing any legal charges over that. And there was one situation where there was a group of, I think, 15 online teachers working in Chiang Mai, but they were using like a shared office space, and they were working for a Thai company,
without a weapon. And they came in and busted the whole lot of them. But that's totally different from, you know, freelancing, working on your own, in the comfort of your home, comfort of your own house or apartment. So, short answer, officially illegal, nobody cares. Any other questions? No. Okay, cool. Well, if you want to hang around and chat to us and chat to each other, you can go grab a coffee in the room over there, a glass of water, whatever, and you can ask us any questions that you have. Thank you very much, everybody who came today. It's kind of interesting to see how many people would turn up. The event actually got 50 people said they were going to come, but you know, we got a good amount, so I'm quite happy with that. And yeah, thank you for coming, and I hope you enjoyed the presentations and you learned something from that. And again, go to networking now if you want to have a chat with us. All right, thank you guys.